which they provide. So actually, I will talk about two topics during this talk. The first one is how to use partially affine covariant features. So like sift, or we have some information, but we don't have time to really recover the full affine frame. And we still want to use this information to estimate some models. And the second part of the talk will be about how to get, what are the benefits and what are the drawbacks of using affine correspondences, and how to get, even though the affine transformation is being noisy, how to get accurate solutions, even more accurate solutions than by using point correspondences. So this is, today you have seen many different ellipses. It's just another example of ellipses with affine correspondences. So I might just go through the jump to the second slide. So here you saw this in the introduction, this slide, and basically these are again just examples of affine correspondences. Says I'm jumping to the next because you have seen many ellipses today already. Okay, so what can be, so today you heard about many different kind of geometric models that can be estimated from affine correspondences. From Levente, you heard about surface normal, fundamental matrix, homography, etc. From Jimmy, you heard about single view problems. And all of these methods require us estimating affine covariant features. And the problem with that, this, I'm not sure what is happening in the background. There's some animation which I forgot to turn off, but okay. So all of these methods which require fully affine covariant features means that we have to really detect fully affine covariant features, which can be time consuming in many cases, especially if we run some affine sift, which requires U synthesis, something like that. That really is time consuming in most of the cases. And there are, to the best of my knowledge, I don't know any fully affine covariant feature detector which runs in real time. But actually, there are things which we could use to have some fine information about the scene. So for example, we can use sift where we have scale and orientation. We can use orb where we have a rotation, etc. So like we can use this information to improve our estimation and also speed the robust estimation up. Okay. Something weird is happening with my presentation. Let me quickly check it. Something. Dimitro, you know how, I think I should turn off the animations totally. And that is maybe in animations, no.
So I don't know.
It's in the settings of the document, I think. I turned off.
File preference, probably. Properties or what?
No.
No.
You are getting closer and closer. Slideshow, maybe. Wait. Subtitle. No.
Tools. Macro format.
Slide. Insert. No view.
I don't know actually what's going on.
No, this is different. Mm-hmm. It will be somewhere here, I think.
Okay, here's
maybe design, way design, slide, no, design, no. Translation.
None. Slideshow. Timings, narrations.
Set, sorry. No, there was a. Okay, I will solve it. Don't worry, I think. I just start to continue it and then I will jump to the correct part. Start here. Okay, so this is the actual form of this slide. So again, just a refreshing of what happens. For example, when we have some partially affine covariant features, what this means. So we can have other we can have some parts of the affine correspondence. We can know the orientation of the feature, for example, by this gradient voting method, which was discussed by Dima in depth. Or we can have some scale information. That scale, for example, in sift comes from the scale space. So we know something about the shape of the region, which we could actually use for estimating our model. So in this case, we have, when having scale and orientation invariant features, we can have, we have a point coordinates, we have a feature orientation written as alpha here, and we have a feature size 2, which is some scalar value. During my talk, I will use orb for orientation covariant features. These orb features also have some scale, but it's reasonably noisy, so I've never used them. So I will call orientation invariant features orb features, and I will call scale and orientation invariant features sift features in my talk. But we can replace it with any other kind of feature detector, which gives the same output. Okay, so the question is, how to use, so we have seen solvers using affine correspondences. The question is how to use this size and orientation information, how to connect this information to the actual geometry in the background. And we have multiple options. We can, for example, convert the sift correspondence to two-point correspondences, as it is written like here. So here we have this point correspondence that is the middle of the region, that is the center of the region which we detected. And then we have the orientation, we have the size, and we simply generate new point correspondences here. These are the equations here, but you can imagine how it works. And we can do exactly the same with affine correspondences. So we can say that we have, these are the detected regions, oriented ellipses again. And then we detect here this P and Q, and here P prime prime and Q prime prime. And the positive thing about this solution is that all kinds of point-based solvers work when we choose this option. So we first convert the affine correspondences or sift correspondences or whatever to point correspondences, and then we use any kind of affine features. The problem with this is that when having two-view geometry, we usually define the affine correspondences as a partial derivative of the imaging function at the particular point. What this means in practice, this means that if we, that affine correspondence, affine transformation, that shape information is true, it is correct only infinitely close to the region. So this means that as soon as, where is the cursor? So as soon as I generate points outside that infinitely close region, that won't be true anymore. So that only will only be an approximation. So this P prime and Q prime won't really be point correspondences. They will be kind of depending on how rough our approximation is, but they are theoretically incorrect. But again, this is a simple solution and all point-based solvers work, which is nice. What other things can I do? Okay, here it is. So if I have this scale and orientation information, I can simply say that, okay, this is my affine frame. There is no shear, and I consider the scales along the axis to be the same. Of course, this is again a rough approximation, but then I can use all the affine-based solvers, which usually are easy and based on linear constraints, so they can be easily applied. But again, similarly as before, this is a very coarse approximation. So in this case, again, the scale is assumed to be uniform along the axis, which is not really true in most of the cases. And the shear is assumed to be zero, which is again not the nice thing. In practice, it doesn't really happen often. But this approximation still works in short baseline cases. I will show you some experiments later. So this is again something which we could do when having scale and orientation invariant features. What is the third thing, which I will discuss in more depth, is the direct usage of such features. What this means, so we could design solvers. I'm not sure what is happening, by the way, with the slides, but I'm trying always to find the right configuration. Okay. Here it is. So what this means, using this information directly in the solvers, this means that we need to first understand how the orientation and scale coming from the features really, what is the relationship of that with respect to the epipolar geometry or to the geometry which we have in the background. And also I have to design new solvers that use this information and estimate what we currently want to estimate. So the thing is that, yes, a theoretically correct interpretation is, I think, an important problem mathematically. But in vision, of course, we usually care about things which actually work in practice. And if the point conversion works in practice, then there is no real reason behind besides being a nice thing to have a theoretically working thing. There's no real reason in doing such things. So the question is, what's the difference between these kind of three approaches when doing the estimation? Because in many cases we have lots of approximations when doing this thing. When estimating the scale, this comes from the scale space that is already quite noisy, and also the orientations. So everything is noisy. The question is if it is matter that we have a noisy interpretation of that orientation scale or not. And I run an experiment to figure this out. So this is on Kitty essential matrix estimation using the 5-point algorithm. And you can see that we have this error, rotation translation, inlier number and runtime of the robust estimation. And if I convert the six features to 2-point correspondences, the rotation is kind of similar. The translation is slightly worse, but we have slightly fewer, okay, the coloring is not correct for the inliers, but we have slightly fewer inliers. The solver is, I would say, much faster, but I would say the results here are kind of similar. What happens if I use the approximation? That is, I think, even better than using the 5-point algorithm, because we have the same accuracy, but it is 3 times faster than by using the 5-point algorithm in robust estimation. And I can use the direct 3-sift solver too, which in this case is the best in terms of accuracy, slightly slower than the affine approximation. But again, there's not a big difference between all these methods. I would say all of them are kind of similar. This is on Kitty. If I go to phototourism, then I will see completely different things. So on Kitty, of course, the motion is quite easy. The car moves on the plane. Actually, for this experiment, the baseline was varying. I mean, I didn't just use the every second frame, but I was constructing the image pairs from frames further away. But still, it's kind of an easy problem. When I use phototourism, which has a more diverse data set, the thing which I see is that when the sift to point conversion when compared to the 5-point algorithm is reasonably okay. It has similar accuracy, slightly better translation. It is much slower. The reason why it's slower is because it's noisy. So RANSAC has to do more iterations in the end, so it becomes slower. If I do this sift to a fine approximation, that is quite bad. It doesn't work. Even though on Kitty it was very good. When the motion is more complex than this, assuming that there is no shear and the scales along the axis is the same, doesn't really work. And in this case, when I use the solver which directly estimates the model from sift correspondences. Leads to the best accuracy while being much, much faster than the other algorithms. So this was kind of a motivation why it makes really sense to go for directly understanding, directly interpreting the sift features and or features, and not just using some conversion, some approximation, which would make our life easier. By the way, anytime when you have questions, feel free to stop me and ask these questions. Okay, so we now understand that it's important to try finding some interpretation of the rotation and scales of such features. The question is how to interpret them. And actually the thing which worked reasonably well is try interpreting them as known parts of an unknown affine correspondence. So in this case, we have two rotations in the two images. We have two scales, two sizes on the two images, but we don't know the shear and we don't know the scales along the axis, basically. So in the images, this size that we have from the C features is not really the scale. It's something else. It's basically the area. It is proportional to the area of the region on which the point lies. And we can use this model, this affine transformation model, where this part is basically it's a rotation and upper triangular matrix, and we can say that we know the rotation. This is in one image. This is a one image. This is a model, and we know that size which the shift gives me is kind of proportional to the area of the region. We can easily say that the determinant of that affine transformation, that local affine frame in this case, should be equal to the square of the size of the shift feature. This is one image. We have the same in the second image, and we can easily. And we can get the affine transformation from the first to the second image using this formula. And here, this is how we interpret the scale change, basically. So that will be the determinant of the affine transformation. So this gives us equations because we know the rotation, because we know basically the determinant. And the thing which we don't know is the shear and like another scale, basically. So this is how you can imagine this. So we have we have two images. We observe a 3D point lying on some 3D surface. And we have a rotation in the first image, rotation in the second image. We have a size in the first image, size in the second image. And basically the scale change will be, of course, the fraction of the sizes and the angle will be the angle, basically the difference of the orientations. Okay. Using these constraints, this interpretation, which I've just described to you, we propose the method. I'm not sure what happens with the PowerPoint, but I'm trying to. Okay, so here all the things are visible. So this was, I think, the first method using this kind of interpretation to estimate something from C features. And in this paper, we estimated homographies from these features. We estimated fundamental matrices from these features. But the interesting part for the tutorial is the part where homography is estimated from three ORP features. Precisely, it's two ORP plus one point, but it doesn't matter at this point. So we want to estimate, in this case, from three oriented features, the homography which belongs to this plane highlighted in blue. So here what happens, basically, we use the homography. So Levente described the homography to a affine correspondence relationship. So it actually is, the affine correspondence is the partial derivative of the homography matrix along the image with respect to the image directions. So we can have this constraint here, which gives us an equation for each of the affine elements. We can, after expanding these equations, we actually get these four linear equations. And then into these equations, we can simply replace the affine elements with the affine model, which we just described earlier. And we basically substitute this into these equations. And then we get these four equations in this case, which can be done. So this will be the relationship of shift feature oriented, in this case oriented and scaled features given the homography. And then we can formalize some solver. In this case, we have three oriented features. This means that we have three point correspondences plus the orientation. So we can use three point correspondences to form a system of six linear equations. We can use that to calculate the null space, a three-dimensional null space. So in this case, we end up having three unknowns, alpha, beta, and gamma. One of them can be fixed to one. And then we can use the equations coming from the orientations to use that to solve for that two unknown variables, alpha and beta. So this is one way for using orientations for estimating homography in two views. And this can be solved in two, in closed form. This is a pretty fast algorithm. The second algorithm, which I want to show you, this is from ICCV 3 years ago. Here, the goal was to use not just the orientation, but use the orientation and scale for estimating homography from two sift features. And in this case, basically what we did, we again use the same interpretation as what I've shown you before. We say that this is the affine transformation comes like this from the frames in each image. Then we know, so we have some equation for the inverse. This is just a well-known equation for calculating the inverse. We can make it simpler even by recognizing that there are some trigonometric identities, and also we use the determinant constraints, which I've shown to you earlier. Okay, here is the slide. And then after some variable elimination techniques, I wouldn't like to go deeper into this, but we can find out what, so these two equations basically are the relationship of the affine elements and the scale and the orientation coming from the sift features. So this doesn't even contain the homography here. This is just the relationship of the affine elements and the scale and orientation, but using these relationships, these equations, we can plug them into the well-known homography to affine correspondence equations, and we can end up with these two equations. And the nice thing about them is that the first one is linear. This means that it can be easily used for estimating the homography. And the second one is quadratic, which is not as easy to be used when having a big system, but it can still be. What we do then, so we have now two sift correspondences, which basically is two point correspondences and four and two size and orientation correspondences basically. And in this case, we again can form a null space, three-dimensional null space, and we can estimate the solution, the final homography, using the quadratic equations in the end coming from the scales. So as a conclusion, when having sift features, basically each sift feature gives us, besides the point correspondences, besides the two constraints from the point correspondences, each sift feature gives us in total four equations, which can be used for estimating the homography in any, even in any specialized cases. So for example, we tried this idea, try these constraints when having gravity direction, and using the same constraints, we can significantly simplify the estimation problem. Why it's relevant having gravity direction? In many cases, when having our smartphones, when having drones or some anything which has IMU inside, basically we can easily get a very accurate estimation of the gravity direction that can be used basically to reduce the degrees of freedom of the estimation problem. So for example, if we know if you try to estimate the relative pose of two cameras, when having the gravity direction, this means that the rotation, we don't have to estimate the full rotation matrix. We only need to estimate the rotation around the vertical axis, because the camera coordinate systems can be aligned by using the gravity direction. So this greatly simplifies our estimation problem. What we proposed here in this paper, we propose a solver which estimates the homography from a single sift feature in case of when the correspondence is from the ground plane. Also, we had a solver for estimating from a sift feature plus a point correspondence and also from two orb correspondences. What happens when estimating it from sift feature? We assume that the point lies on the ground plane. What this means, so we don't know the orientation of the camera around the vertical axis. We don't know the translation of the camera. So this is actually a scene where these things happen. And in this case, we can put together all the equations which I have shown you in the previous slides. And we get some null space then because we assume that the point is on the ground plane, we can easily say that the homography normal will be exactly this, and then this will give us additional constraints, and we can in the end solve the homography given a single correspondence. Why is it nice? So when we estimate the homography from a single correspondence, that's equivalent to estimating the estimating the essential matrix, basically. Because what happens? What is the constraint when having homographies? We assume the points in the minimal sample to be coplanar, right? If there's only one point in the minimal sample, then this constraint doesn't really exist anymore. So we can easily decompose the homography to rotation and translation, and that is almost the same as having an essential matrix in these cases. So this is a nice thing. We can use it for basically immediately decomposing to pose and then validating the pose in a RANSEC procedure. Also in this paper, there was another solver proposed. This is for estimating the homography when having a horizontal plane observed. And in this case, we have two additional unknowns, basically. We, again, don't know the orientation around the vertical axis. We don't know the translation of the camera. But in this case, we don't know the normal of the feature of the plane on which the point lies, but we know that it is horizontal. So this NY is zero. The solution is, again, reasonably similar as the previous one. So we put all the linear equations together, what we have, estimate the null space, then we use the quadratic constraints from the C feature and also the constraints coming from the normal to estimate the rest of the parameters. And this is so of course it is not as nice as having a single point for the estimation, but it still is much faster than using four correspondences than estimating the homography. And also we can do this for general plane, and that is that leads to a two sift and two orb solver. Why it's okay, because to compare to the previous general, so in the previous, I don't know which slide, I showed you a solver which estimated the homography from two sift solvers. What's the difference when having gravity direction? Then this is simplified slightly, so we don't need to have sift corresponds. We don't need to have the scale. The orientation is enough. Why it's nice? The orientation usually is much more accurate than the size of the patch. So this will lead to more accurate solutions. Okay. So this was about how to use sift and or features for estimating homography. The second question, which was basically in the last, it automatically does things. So basically in the last 2 years, I was thinking about how to try solving the relative pose problem from sift features. And I finally figured out, I wanted to show you the steps, how I got to figuring this out. So how can we formalize the problem of relative pose and sift features? We can try saying that, again, the sift feature is a known part of an unknown affine transformation, and then we can use the affine transformation to fundamental matrix constraints, which is actually here, and it was shown by Levente. So this means actually that the affine transformation should transform the normal of the epipolar line from the first image to the second image. It should rotate it, and also there is some scale constraint which should be satisfied here. And we can say that, okay, we have this constraint. We can easily substitute the affine model, how we interpreted the scale and orientation given the affine transformation, and then try solving the problem. The problem is that when we do this, what happens? So basically each affine correspondence has four parameters. I consider two of them to be known, orientation and scale. But there is two other unknowns, basically, share and other orientation. So this means that each correspondence gives me two unknowns, and it gives me two equations from this equation here. So this means that each correspondence gives me nothing for solving this problem. It doesn't give any information. So this is not the way to go. There's a big X showing that it's really not the way to go. What else can we do? We can maybe say that, okay, again, the affine transformation is an unknown, is known part of the orientation and scale is a known part of the unknown affine transformation. And then we try formalizing it through the homography equations, which we had, which are nice. We like them. That is four linear equation, easy to use. It's written here. But the problem is that each sift correspondence will give us six linear equations, two from the point correspondences, four from this, basically. And it gives us a plus two times n unknowns. It can be solved from n correspondences. But the problem is that as soon as I need more than one correspondence, it's a homography, and it's not really equivalent to solving for the relative pose. So it's not really what we want to do. Again, a big X, so it's not what we want to do. Okay, another attempt, which again didn't work. So we can maybe use the constraints which you derived in the previous slides from sift to homography. And again, the problem is the same. We could solve the problem, but not from a single sift feature. And if it's not solved from a single sift correspondence, basically, then it's still a homography and not some relative pose which we want to solve. And actually, the thing which worked is to try parameterizing the affine correspondence as this using the usual determinant constraints. And also we added a new constraint saying that it should rotate so parameterizing via oriented circles in this case. So here, this is the orientation in the first image, second image, and this will be basically circles in the images. And we say that it should transform the circle from the first image and use this constraint together with all the other constraints what we had. And basically we put all these things into a variable elimination technique. And we ended up these three nice equations here. Here the first two are new. This third is kind of this is the determinant constraint what we had. So this is basically the determinant of the affine transformation, the minus determinant of the affine transformation. And this is the scale change. So this is basically the determinant constraint what we had in the previous slide, actually here. But we generated two new constraints which connect the affine elements to the sift orientation and scale. And these can be used to estimate after some tricks, after doing some elimination again, these new constraints can be plugged into the fundamental matrix, the affine transformation equation. And then we get this equation. What's nice about this? It's a linear equation in the parameters of the fundamental matrix. So this means that when we have a sift correspondence, we have a linear equation from the point correspondence part, and we have a linear equation from the scale and orientation part. So this means that we can basically use any existing point-based solvers, which starts from by null space decomposition, which basically most of them, as I know. So we can use any solvers. And we will need half of the correspondences than what we would need otherwise by using just point correspondences. So basically when we use the seven point, I have a mistake here. Okay, when we use the seven point fundamental matrix estimation algorithm, we should need four sift features. When we use the 5-point essential matrix estimation estimator, we need three sift points. When we estimate the fundamental matrix again from six correspondences, we in that case need just three sift features again. So basically we have the number of features which are required for estimating the geometric model which we want to estimate. So this is a nice thing and easily usable thing in practice. Okay. Okay, so this was the first part of the presentation. Actually, as I see, I'm talking faster than when I talked last time when I practiced it. That partly because of getting slightly tired. So we might finish earlier, so all of you can be happy. So this was the first part. In the first part of the presentation, I discussed how. Sorry. We will get there. So of course these. I just wanted to show that even if we don't have full affine correspondences, we can do things. Actually, if you go for homography estimation, the 2 points, the two sieve solver is quite good. And when you go for relative pose estimation, this new constraint can be used anywhere in any relative pose estimation task by just adding that constraint to the any of the point-based solvers. And that is easy. I mean, yes. So basically, you download any solver, Stevenius solver, or Nichter solver for the 5-point algorithm. It starts with generating the coefficient matrix coming from the point correspondences, and then do things. And that coefficient matrix, you basically replace the linear equations by these ones, and then it's solved basically. So it's quite easy to be used. So any questions regarding this part, by the way? So Before going into the second part of the talk. Good, everybody understood everything. That's good. I'm happy. Second part will be slightly closer to the ground. The things which I want to discuss here is what are the benefits of affine transformations, what are the drawbacks, and how to solve these problems, and some additional practical algorithms which help when doing model estimation. What are the benefits? So when using affine or partially affine correspondences, we need fewer correspondences to estimate the geometric models, what we want to estimate. And this means that when we use some randomized robust estimator, which goes with selecting minimal samples and then doing random selection, et cetera, we have to do significantly fewer iterations. Okay, so here, this is an example for that. The horizontal axis is the outlier ratio. This is the adaptive Ransack tabulation criterion, basically. Horizontal axis is the outlier ratio, the vertical axis is the required number of Ransack iterations to achieve some confidence. As I remember, it's 0.99 in this case. That is what is often used in Ransack when estimating anything in real world. And the thing which you can see here, for example, for fundamental matrix estimation, when using point correspondences, this is the purple slide, so for example, when we have 60% outliers, the curve, so the number of iterations that should be done by Ransack is somewhere, I don't know, around the not necessarily that far up the ceiling, but reasonably high. When we use affine correspondences, so this is the yellow curve, at 60% of outliers, we have to do maybe 20 iterations, of course, in theory. So this is in theory. So in theory, when using affine correspondences, the robust estimation is much, much faster. In practice, the robust estimation is very dependent on it's very sensitive to the complexity of the problem. This means that if we have many correspondences, if we need many correspondences to estimate something, the likelihood of really estimating an accurate model is much, much lower, of course, so we less likely will find a good model. So for example, here's an example, and this is on photo tourism. You can see some detectors. This is we get affine correspondences using AFNET. Here we compare different kind of methods too. So what we would get with using superpoint with superglue, what we would get with other methods. I included superpoint with superglue because that's a state of the art method for estimating relative pose here. And if I just check these two rows, the difference is that for the top one, we use an affine correspondence based solver. Why for the bottom one, we use the 5-point algorithm. What you see in the columns. So here, for example, here the average pose error, median pose error, AUX score, so that should be high, the errors should be low. AUX score at 2.5, 5, 10, and 20 degrees. So basically that is the area under the curve, under the accuracy curve, it should be as high as possible. Okay, but you can imagine, so for example, AUX 5 means that this number is the ratio of cases when the error is smaller than 5 degrees. Okay, so in this case, it's 81%, for example. And when using, when jumping from the five-point algorithm to the to an affine correspondence-based solver, you can see that the error is significantly decreased. The AUX score is significantly increased. Okay, the inlier number did not, but it doesn't really matter in practice. I mean, the thing which matters is the pose accuracy in this case. So you can see that if we know how to use them right, having affine correspondences really does improve the accuracy. And it also allows designing new robust estimators. So for example, I show you this one. This is a secret. Currently, we are working on this robust estimator. But the thing which I want to show you is that compared to superpoint plus superglue, which is a state-of-the-art algorithm, especially the high accuracy case. So for example, superpoint with superglue, the 67% of its errors are lower than 2.5 degrees. When using affine correspondences with a special algorithm designed for affine correspondences, then this is improved by almost 10%, which is a lot. So we are talking about here around 10,000 image pairs. So 10% of the 10,000 image pairs is like, for 1,000 image pairs, it is better. It is much, much better than a superpoint with superglue. And this, of course, for this, we need to know how to use these affine correspondences, but they are capable of leading to very good results. This is another table I showed this in the beginning. But this is again some motivation. And this 3-sift solver, which I showed you in the beginning, and here, this is actually, I'm not sure what is happening with the presentation, but I'm trying to find, this is actually with this constraint, which I've showed you previously. So here, that is the normal 5-point algorithm, which we use for the 3-sift solver, but with half of the correspondences, basically. And the thing which you have seen earlier and you see it now, of course, for easy scenes, it doesn't matter. We can do anything. But for harder scenes, it really does matter. And it can improve the accuracy. And also the runtime. So here the runtime is shown too. So besides the accuracy, it's also faster due to requiring fewer ANSYS iterations. Some other benefits, so we can use these covariant features for homography estimation and then for multi-homography estimation. And when we plug this into some multi-model estimator, in this case, basically we want to find the planes in the images, the homographies in the images. I'm just showing only the first image of each image pair in this case, the color assigns to planes. And when using this 1-sift solver, we can see that the results, so these are errors, misclassification errors, basically the ratio of points which are assigned to the wrong plane. This is time. And again, compared to the 4-point homography estimator, which is the well-known widely used homography estimator, when we go for example, this SIFT method, that improves the multi-homography estimation a lot and also speeds it up. Okay, and if you look at, so for example, when using this 1-sift solver for homography estimation, then this plane is found. When using the 4-point homography estimator, this plane is not found. I'm not sure if it's easy to see there, but there actually are blackish points there, which are the points assigned to that plane, which are not there in the second image. Okay, Also, using affine correspondences is very important for wide baseline matching. As Dimitri have already covered this this topic, I just wanted to show you two things: a table and a plot. But basically, this is the on very challenging data sets. The image matching results when using some affine based detectors. And here, or only one of them do not use it, and that is the orb. And you can see that orb didn't solve any of the image pairs. So we, in this case, need affine covariant feature detectors to be able to solve at least some of the image pairs in this extremely hard data set. This is the same test here. The horizontal axis are basically different image pairs, and the vertical axis is the number of the correct inliers. And the thing which you can see, basically, this means that only those methods are on the top. So only those methods find a reasonable number of inliers, which use affine correspondences for the matching. So these are the benefits. If we use the affine correspondence as well, then we really can get accurate results. But the problems are, so as Dimitri showed and also Jimmy mentioned, they are very sensitive to noise. So for example, if you look at these four images, which you have seen like three times today, then you can see that the top is the top row is the observed patch in two images. The bottom row is the warp patch in the two images, followed by the affine transformation which you find. And you can see that it seems very good. It really seems seems good. But the problem is that if we have an image and we go for point correspondences, and the point correspondences are far from each other, then moving them by 1 pixel, 2 pixel, does change the result, but it's not the estimation is not as bad. It doesn't become as bad by having a few pixel noise, basically. When having affine correspondences, those are local things. So if I locally move a point a few pixels away, that changes the affine transformation a lot, and that will affect my geometric estimation. So if I just plug the affine solvers into RANSEC, this is basically what I get. What you see here, and this, by the way, coincides with what Jimmy showed in the end of his talk. So here the horizontal axis is some kind of error of fundamental matrix or essential matrix estimation. I can't remember which exactly. So some relative pose estimation problem. The vertical axis is the probability. So this basically is the CDF, a cumulative distribution function. What it means, so for example, here, the probability of the red curve, of the method with the red curve having lower than 0.1% error, 0.1 error is like 90%, which is nice. What's the differences of these curves? Basically, these are different detectors, but the interesting thing that the ones with circle are using affine correspondences. The ones with crosses use only point correspondences. And you can see that there is a significant accuracy gap between the ones using affine correspondences and the ones not using affine correspondences. And this is inside one in the RANSEC. So we just run RANSEC. In the end, of course, there is a refitting on the inlier point correspondences. Still, the accuracy is very different in these cases. So we have to really do something to get good results. The question is what to do. We can do, for example, local optimization. And that will actually be the solution. But a question is, what kind of local optimization should we do? So here is, again, a phototourism data set on around 10,000 image pairs. Precisely, it's 9,900, two scenes from the data set. It's automatically moving. OK, what happens here? Yes. As a baseline, there is GC RANSEC with a 5-point solver in the top row. And you can see that the results are really very good. This is, again, the average pose error, median pose error, the AUX scores with different thresholds and the inlier numbers. Then we use affine correspondences in vanilla RANSEC, which is not even true here because I'm not using vanilla RANSEC. I'm using Prozac sampling, degeneracy testing, SPRT for the preemption, and final bundle adjustment. So it's a really advanced ransack, but without local optimization, basically. We get very bad results. So without local optimization, it doesn't make sense to use affine correspondences because the results like 3 times worse for the average and like 13 times worse for the median than by using point correspondences. So it's not really the way to go. What else can we do? We can use as local optimization least squares fitting. When I talk about local optimization, I only mean locally optimizing on only the point correspondences. So I kind of forgot to mention this. So what happens here? We generate minimal sample models by affine correspondences. Okay, we found the next best model, and then we do local optimization, but only using the point correspondences from the, we kind of forget about the affine shapes inside the local optimization. So when I do least squares fitting here, I do least squares fitting on the inlier point correspondences of that particle minimal sample model, which was used in the local optimization. And you can see that least squares fitting is, again, not the thing that we solve our problem. It improves the results slightly, but still it is very, very, very far from what we want to achieve. So this is not really what we want to do. We can also do iterated least squares fitting. That is, again, slightly better than using least squares fitting or no local optimization at all. Of course, we could do iteratively least squares fitting. That wouldn't solve the problem again. But a thing which kind of solves the problem is using inner ransack, and that is kind of the key of getting accurate results. What this means? We have a minimal sample model estimated from affine correspondences. We have n inliers from it. Okay, then we start a local optimization. And in that local optimization, we use that n inliers to sample from only the point correspondences. And then we use in the local optimization these minimal sample models with a few iterations of ransack. And that, if you have a look on the results here, it improves a lot. And now if you check, for example, the average is not better, but the median all the other AUX scores are better than the baseline. So with using inner ransack, we already exceeded the results of the baseline. So which used point correspondences. We can do another thing, which is slightly more advanced. We can use GC ransack's local optimization. In this case, basically we consider the spatial coherence of points. What this means, so we say that points close to each other likely come from the same geometric model, and this is used in GC ransack local optimization. And using this further improves the results. So you can see here that compared to the ground truth, compared to the baseline, which is GC ransack with a 5-point solver, we can achieve better results in terms of all metrics here. So the average is smaller, better and smaller, and all the other metrics are higher, especially on these accurate cases. I mean, in the AUK 2.5 and 5 degrees cases, it improves like with 6 by 6 percentages, which is a lot again. So this means that in the 6 percentage of the image pairs, the results were better or lower. Sorry? You have a question? Okay. Yeah, of course, come. I was waiting for you.
So just to clarify, this is operating only off of the responses.
Inner ransack. Yes, it's a very good question because I didn't mention that it's not operating on one correspondence. It's operating on 5 correspondence basically. No, yes. So it's operating on the point correspondences. So you need more than one there. So you need. Which uses only the points of the inliers selected from the using the minimal sample model coming from the affine correspondence. And then you sample from the inliers and then you refit and you resample and. Inline point correspondence. So here, so again, I forget all shape information when doing the local optimization.
Do you relax the threshold?
No. No, it's all the same. So I'm.
The ground current side, that's using this basically.
It's also just for the inline reselection. So what happens here, you go into the local optimization. In the local optimization, basically, you can do, so you go in with n inliers, you select randomly that is in the RANSEC, you refit if you find a better, then you reselect the inliers and that is in the RANSEC. What else you can do, you go into the local optimization, that is the GC RANSEC thing. You have the inliers, you use that for sampling, and when reselecting the inliers, you use that energy minimization based graph cut, basically, using the pairwise terms there. Exactly. Yeah. Good. Other questions? Oh, we have lots of questions.
Yes. But let me formulate this in a different way.
Uh-huh.
So, what you're doing is basically you create, you estimate some model with using affine correspondence, and now you're actually not use any geometry of this model, but you use this as outlier prefiltering, and then you do just vanilla runs out inside and feed the model and then get the grade.
Exactly, but it is done, of course, in an iterative manner. I mean, it's done jointly, but this is actually what happens, right? Yes. So the affine correspondences really are for preselecting reasonably good inlier, potential inliers, and then the final model is used, is estimated from points. And because they are noisy, so we cannot really rely on them, but we can use the fact that we have solvers which estimate the models from fewer correspondences. And this means that we have to do fewer iterations and we can basically generate models using fewer features. And then we can forget about everything else. We can use the normal things which we usually use. And this is how we get better results when using affine correspondences. Okay, so this was about the accuracy. This was really the last slide about how to get accurate results when having point correspondences. What else when having affine correspondences? What else we can do? So there are many, many other algorithms which can be used to make them more practical. So for example, when having the four-point algorithm for homography estimation, we usually do the chirality check. What this means? This means that we have a minimal sample in two images, and we basically check the orientation the ordering of the points in the images. If the ordering changes, so here the color denotes, so for example, here the ordering is like clockwise, here it's counterclockwise, and if it changes in two images, this means that the two images see the different sides of the plane. This is often used in practice, and this is for early rejection of the minimal sample. So without estimating the model, we basically reject the model by just checking this chirality constraint, and that really really speeds up the robust estimation in practice. The question is if we can do something similar for affine correspondences, and of course we can do. And here I will do the thing which I didn't do when doing the estimation. I'm converting the affine correspondence to point correspondences like this. So you can see here the point correspondences. And then we can apply the same chirality check as what we did for the four-point algorithm. Why I did convert this to points. So here, the accuracy does not really depend on this conversion. This is just for the here. So I can check again the ordering. I can do the same thing, but in this case, the accuracy doesn't really depend on the ordering. Here, this is just for the quick rejection. If you rejected something which might have been good and it is rejected because of the approximation, we survive that because we do many, many iterations. If we kept something because of the approximation which shouldn't have been kept, there is no problem. So at most we verify count it's in layers and continue and nothing changes. So here the approximation is doesn't really matter, just for the quick rejection. And here we can see some results. Again, this is the CDF, so the cumulative distribution function. The horizontal axis is the processing time in milliseconds. The vertical axis is the probability again. The thing which you can see here is that these two curves are for point correspondences. This kind of validates that for point correspondences, it's really important to do this chirality check, but it also speeds things slightly up when having affine correspondences. Not as much, of course, because it's already much, much faster due to requiring only two correspondences for the estimation, but still it speeds up and there's no cost of doing this chirality check. So it's basically, I would say, like five or six lines of code and we get some improvement. What else can we do? We can do lots of other things. For example, we can do uncertainty estimation using affine correspondences. So here we can, we can put together all the constraints which we have. This can be done, of course, for point correspondences too. We can put together all the correspondences, all the constraints what we have. We can go for I've jumped to the second slide. We can go for uncertainty estimation. And here it can be done in the similar way as it can be done for point correspondences. So we have constraints coming from the affine features, constraints what we discussed earlier or what we discussed with Levent earlier. We put into the Jacobian calculation and then we estimate the uncertainty. And that can be used in many ways. We actually tried using it for preemption in RANSEC, for speeding up RANSEC, but it still can be used for many things, for estimation, for weighted least square splitting, for improving samplers based on uncertainty. But when used as a preemption, what preemption is? Basically, what happens in RANSEC, when we have a new minimal sample model, we check all points if they are inliers or not. When we have a preemptive strategy, that means that we don't want to check all points. We want to interrupt this checking when we are sure that it won't be the best model. So this is a strategy for avoiding to verify all points when having a new model. And here are some results again. So the thing what you can see here is that actually, I don't show here the only uncertainty-based solution. It's worse than the SPRT. But when combined with SPRT, which is state-of-the-art preemption technique, it can lead to better, to faster results. And this is for, actually, I forgot, I think, to put the problems there. But yes, I think this is fundamental matrix, this is homography, and this is essential matrix. So the message from here is that we can use this uncertainty to speed up the procedure. We can use also to do different things, even when having affine correspondences. And that was kind of the presentation, but just some take-home messages. Actually, there are two important things I would say. So the first thing is, as what Dimitris said in his talk, so we usually have more than just the point locations, and we should use that additional information that can help us in estimating models, rejecting samples early, doing many, many things. So we have the information which usually is rejected, just forgotten when doing model estimation, while we can improve our results by using them. And the second message is what I've shown you in the tables is basically if we don't use some inner RANSEC based thing in our local optimization, we won't get good results. If we do, then we can get much better results than by using point correspondences. And this is why these algorithms are reasonably simple. So implementing an inner RANSEC into a local optimization takes 15 minutes if you know how to do it. It's not trivial that this will solve our problem. And I think that was my last slide. I was slightly shorter, which is good in this case. And thank you for your attention. Any questions? No. Thank you. I became quite tired by the end. Well, in the beginning too, but that's another thing. Yeah, jet lag too.
I wondered, some player you do this with essentially a search for admire and I wonder
what do you mean under inline scale?
Your threshold basically.
But that's fixed.
Wait, it's fixed, but you're searching for all the noise parameters.
So it depends on the actual algorithm. So of course you can use fixed threshold, you can use max sec based marginalization based threshold, you can use a contrario solution where you select the threshold, but that is, I would say, independent on this affine transformation part. In all tests which I've shown you, it's a fixed threshold. I don't really do anything with the threshold inside the local optimization. It's just fixed.
The reason why I ask is only because these fine-grained regions are just required. But again, in the low population, I guess you are only using one correspondence probably from the shape parameters, maybe some search for.
You mean thresholding the shape parameters? So having a threshold not just for the point coordinates, not just for the point locations, but also for the shape parameters.
Something like this, uh-huh. Where you know that there's different different parts of the feature or configuration. So
that would actually make sense. I never did. So okay, the question was. Yeah, so the question was, let me repeat. So all people in the Zoom room will know what you asked. What did you ask, by the way? Okay, so I remember, don't worry, I remember. Okay, so the question was like searching for the inline affine threshold regarding the shape in the local optimization. That's a good idea. I haven't tried. So the thing is, I wanted always to avoid introducing many new parameters for the affine shape threshold, as an affine shape threshold or something like that. And the thing is that what can it help? In which part can it help? You could do a non-minimal fitting considering the affine shape, but it has never worked for me, whatever I tried. So when I do the non-minimal fitting using the affine frame, it's too noisy, it just makes everything worse. And I don't necessarily see in what else can help using more shape information, basically. Did I answer? Good. Thank you. Other questions? I'm happy to answer if I can. Was it understandable? Yeah, okay, come. Sorry? 70, you remember the slides. Okay, nice, nice. So it was really in the beginning. Okay, the short baseline, that meant there that I can go back. But the only thing I wanted to say, in short baseline, of course, the change is small. So let me go back. Yeah, so the change is small. So if there's a short baseline, then it will, there won't be a big change in terms of affine parameters too. So the shear, having the shear to consider zero is not, okay. big thing. Also, assuming that the scale change along the axis is the same is not a big difference given. So the only thing that if you have a short baseline, this means that it doesn't really change. So if you assume such some parameters to don't change, then that's not that as coarse as otherwise it would be. Yeah, which slide? Okay. Okay, which methods? For these affine. Look, of course, everything is better on a short baseline. So that's a clear thing. If you have short baseline, everything will be. You will find, of course, some things. The translation will be worse, but that's another thing. But you will find more correspondences. You can do your fitting on more things, and then your error will be. The contribution is for short baseline is not as big as for slightly harder scenes where you don't find as many correspondences. So the benefit mostly comes when it's getting harder, basically. Okay. Because when, if you have 90% outliers, inliers, who cares? If you have 90% outliers, which also happens in some wide baseline cases, then sampling five instead something two or five, three instead of five features helps a lot, and especially when doing fundamental matrix estimation, sampling instead of seven correspondences, sampling only three or four again significantly reduces the combinatorics of the problem, so you'll be more likely find your solution in the end. Did I answer? Good. Other questions? If you check the original locally optimized RANSEC paper by Ondra, Hum, and Jiří Matas, they mention this inner RANSEC. So there are like three options or four options there. The things which I actually showed you. So least squares fitting, iterative least squares, also inner RANSEC. So it is written down there.
That's the relation to this image that everyone sees now. So we can ask about this patches.
No, I go over there.
There is a thing which is actually like for estimators like affine and others, which can happen. Whereas you can, like, there are actually two options. Yes. So some model, like if you're working on photometry, it can estimate to like correct rotation, correct the affine parameters, and then everyone is happy. Mm-hmm. But it also can be that, for example, it estimates rotation wrong, but it compensates this with a shear in an opposite direction, and which results in very similarly looking patches, but very different and wrong the geometrical parameters.
But we'll define it. So look, if you end up looking the same, that probably means that your final final summation, if you multiply everything together, is the same, isn't it?
But not quite. Uh-huh. Actually. And so my question is there a way how to and this also was in Timito about how can you incorporate the thing that some parameters can be mixed together, and it was this distortion and focal length.
My short answer is no, I don't know any of such algorithms. But of course, so the thing which we didn't discuss during these talks, so still there is a gap between the interpretation of the affine transformation and the actual detector. So we can assume that the affine transformation is the first order derivative of something of the imaging function, but if it is detected assuming something different, then there will be a gap between the interpretation and the actual geometry and actual estimation, which is yet unclear, I think, in most of the cases.
Is there a case where we're sure that it's always? the detector is based on this.
Yeah, that's a good in synthetic environment. I don't think so. We are just hoping to understand things, and then, and if it works, then it works. Other questions? Good. It's the last chance of asking some nice thing. Okay. So thank you all for coming today for the tutorial. Let the speakers come out so they can all. Okay, so we hope you learned something today. We definitely did. So thank you for being here.
Stop this. Okay.
That's about the chirality.